5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff.
Hey fellow space enthusiasts, my guest this time is Dr. Pete Worden, whose many roles in the space sector over the last decades include having been the director of the NASA Ames Research Center. Among the things he's currently working on is a mission to send tiny spacecraft to the Alpha Centauri system. And there's so much more. Please enjoy my conversation with Pete.
My name is Raphael Rutkin, and I'm an investor and advisor to space companies. Just as a reminder, this podcast is for informational purposes only, and nothing should be taken as investment advice. This podcast is sponsored by NanoAvionics, a satellite manufacturer and mission integrator. Their technologies enable many space companies worldwide to offer services that improve life right here on Earth, such as providing global connectivity, conducting Earth observation, or contributing to scientific discoveries. Check them out, and also check out my episode with their CEO and co-founder. Sadly, I am not a rocket scientist, but I'm an alumnus of the International Space University. ISU offers a number of educational programs about space worldwide. Check them out at isunet.edu.
Everybody, I'm very thrilled to be joined here today by Dr. Pete Worden, who's had a very illustrious career in the space sector in a variety of worlds. Starting as a research astronomer, he was a U.S. Air Force general. He was the head of the NASA Ames Center. He is now the chairman of the Breakthrough Prize Foundation. He's also a lecturer at and trustee of the International Space University and a senior advisor to the Luxembourg Government on space. Pete, did I forget anything?
No, that's perfect. Did I do all that? I guess I did.
Excellent. So lots of things to talk about and to unpack. So why don't we start with one of your main current roles, which is chairman of the Breakthrough Prize Foundation. Do you want to quickly give us the summary of sort of like, you know, what Breakthrough is and how it relates to space and space research?
Sure. The Breakthrough Prize Foundation was founded about 12 years ago, and its original purpose was to encourage young people to go into science. And our founders, the initial founder was Yuri Milner, Israeli and Russian physicist and investor, that he was concerned when he looked at a list of the most admired people on the planet, there were very few scientists. And, you know, you might have Einstein and maybe Stephen Hawking. So he and some other high net worth people that included Mark Zuckerberg and Sergey Brin and Andrew Zwicky and for a while Jack Ma and Ponyma in China, founded the Breakthrough Prize, which is the largest prize in science. That's the awards are almost three times the size of a Swedish prize I won't mention. But what we try to do is, in addition to just giving these prizes, we have a major event. Now, for the last 2 years, it's been postponed because of COVID, but we hope to have it a year from now. And it's going to be called the Oscars of Science. And it was decided to hold that at the campus at NASA Ames Research Center in Silicon Valley. And I was involved in allowing them to use the center. Of course, they invited me to the ceremony, because you always invite the landlord to a big party, especially if you're having it in on their property. During that period, I got to know Mr. Milner and some of the other sponsors pretty well. About 2014, Mr. Milner asked me if I was interested potentially in not just awarding science, but also sponsoring science, particularly related to the question of life in the universe. And I jumped at the chance, and in early 2015, I left NASA, and we started as part of the Breakthrough Prize Foundation, the Breakthrough Initiatives. And the initiatives were designed to really sponsor significant research into the questions of life in the universe, and three in particular. The first one is, in no particular order, was, is there life anywhere in the universe? You know, as I think probably most of your listeners know, that we don't know of life anyplace else. We have some hints that there may be life on Mars and elsewhere in the solar system. So we have a number of programs designed to both see if we can find life in our solar system, or potentially, and maybe more significantly, nearby solar systems. And that's called Breakthrough Watch. The second major project actually started earlier, which was, can we find intelligent life elsewhere? Of course, that always begs the issue, is there intelligent life here? But we'll assume, since we're talking, there is. That was called Breakthrough Listen. And for that project, Mr. Milner committed $100 million for a 10-year program that's often called the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, SETI, or now sometimes more accurately called Technosignatures Research. And that's been going on for about 7 years. And the first two projects, we've had some significant advantages. In the Breakthrough Watch, we've succeeded in getting tentative indications that there's a giant planet orbiting Alpha Centauri A, the nearest star system. It has two solar-type stars. What's interesting about that is that's the scenario of a giant planet orbiting Alpha Centauri A, sort of a Neptune, Saturn-sized planet, is actually the exact scenario in Avatar, and the science fiction movie from over a decade ago. And if people recall the movie, it had a giant planet orbiting Alpha Centauri A called Polyphemus that had a moon that was not only inhabitable, but inhabited by intelligent aliens. I will say there's enough interest in that James Cameron, who was the creator of that, actually appeared at our annual conference to discuss that. So perhaps science fiction preceded fact. The second major kind of discovery or interesting discovery was last fall, Breakthrough Listen, we got our first signal that we initially thought was, it passed all the tests, was an intelligent signal. Interesting enough, it came from the third star in the Alpha Centauri system, Proxima Centauri. We know there's a Earth-sized planet orbiting in the habitable zone of that red dwarf star. Now, we're virtually certain now that that's was terrestrial interference, but it was quite exciting for a while. And our third project is probably my favorite, is that we're, it's called Breakthrough Starshot, and we started this in 2016. And both Breakthrough Listen and Breakthrough Starshot were announced by Yuri Milner in concert with Stephen Hawking, who was our science advisor. And that's designed to figure out, can we send a small probe sometime later this century, 20% the speed of light, and actually go and investigate in person, or in at least by robots, the nearest star system. And that's going along quite well. We're in the midst of our first phase of research. We're anticipating sending that probe by a laser-driven light sail. So it's actually quite exciting. So, but those are the current programs. We're certainly looking at other things. We're looking at potential probes to go to planets in our own solar system, look for life, and also advanced technology efforts to look for life elsewhere.
Those are all very interesting. So let's talk about a little bit about each of them. And I must say, you mentioned Avatar and science fiction in the context of Breakthrough Listen Alpha Centauri. And when you were talking about the audio signal, I immediately thought about the three-body problem, the Chinese novel where we're receiving a message from a planet in the Alpha Centauri system. And of course, the novel tells us we should not answer it. But in any way, maybe picking up on that. So when this Breakthrough Watch or Breakthrough Listen, what kind of signals are we actually watching out for? And are we taking into account sort of, like, even us humans, I guess, you know, we are developing our own technology. So like right now, you know, we're moving away from, in a lot of communications, from radio frequency, and it seems to be like moving towards more and more optical, like laser communications. Is that kind of stuff reflected in what we're, you know, looking out for in Breakthrough Listen, Breakthrough Watch as well?
Well, it's a very interesting question of where to look for alien technology. Again, we don't know what aliens might use. And as you noted, that we're moving from more radio signals to more optical signals. You know, we're looking for a couple things. And in one case, we're looking for a signal which might accidentally be, you know, it wasn't intended for us, but we just intercepted those, called leakage. And that could be anything. It could, if you looked at the Earth from the Alpha Centauri system, for example, one of the signals you might detect is a high-energy radars that are used for air traffic control and so forth. And now it's always been said that, maybe the aliens are listening to I Love Lucy from the 1950s and 60s. The problem with that, of course, is that if the signal from a broadcast television is so weak that if we were to have I Love Gork from Proxima Centauri, we're just now getting big enough radio telescopes to detect that signal. But we're also looking for laser signals. And we have a program that's with a all-sky sort of looking for optical flashes for cosmic ray bursts. Called Veritas. It's a telescope that Harvard University runs in Arizona. And we're looking to see if we see any laser flashes. And we also have another program looking for optical lasers from the nearest stars. It's the Automated Planet Finder at Lick Observatory. An accidental signal could be very, very powerful. Our breakthrough Starshot laser, if we build it, which will have over 100 gigawatts of power, very finely directed. If it was, if you were accidentally in the beam, you could detect it with systems like we have out to billions of light years. So, you know, halfway across the universe. And, you know, we are starting to look at all sky systems. There are also other programs that are beginning to look at that, also privately funded. There's one at University of California, San Diego, that's privately funded, that's looking for these. There are others that people are looking for. So we really don't know. It's interestingly enough, the signal we did get from Proxima Centauri, or what appeared to be from the direction of Proxima Centauri, was at a frequency not usually used for communication. I think it was like 980 megahertz. So we're trying to look as broad as we can. We're looking at low frequencies and high frequencies, and just trying to do as much as we can. Our intent is over the next few years to actually at least look at broadband radio of the million nearest stars. That's up to a complete survey if we can do it out to about 1,000 light years. Now that's more looking for a directed signal that somebody's trying to signal us. Now, as you noted, there's quite a discussion about whether we should signal anybody else. And we've chosen to stay away from that, although we initially had a program called Breakthrough Message that we were thinking about to not send something, but to think about what you would send. And that's probably still an important thing to do. But, you know, the question there is that, you know, a lot of experts say, well, one reason you're not hearing anything is you're not speaking. And of course, there are many others that say, well, sometimes speaking is a bad idea. And so that's quite an interesting argument now. And, you know, I don't know what my position is. It kind of goes back and forth. You know, I do think that, you know, I have a little problem with the three-body problem because it's based on improbable orbital mechanics. You know, the real Alpha Centauri system is not a chaotic set of orbits. I mean, they're quite stable and been stable for billions of years. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, it raises an issue that if we really did get a signal from Proxima Centauri, the nearest star, now the signal that we did get was clearly not, it didn't contain any content. The way we identify a potential techno signature is we look for a very narrow band radio signal, or optical for that matter, because narrow band signals, you know, natural physics, astrophysics processes don't produce very narrow band, either radio or optical signature. So we look for a narrow band, and then we look for something that drifts with time, because the drifting shows that, I mean, this is a something off the Earth that's, you know, it could be an orbit around the Earth, it could be a nearby star system, or it could be someplace else in our solar system, or orbiting, you know, even a planet such as Proxima B, the probable Earth-sized planet in the habitable zone of Proxima Centauri. But then we also look, we take the telescope and we move it on and off the object. So you look, you move it off and you don't see the target, you move it on. Now, one of the problems with this set of observations, they were taken several years ago. We were just getting around to looking at them. Mm-hmm. And they were taken for a slightly different purpose. They were in concert with the Space Observatory tests, the transiting exoplanet survey satellite. And we're really trying to study the flares on Proxima Centauri. And so we had a different mode. The reason we're pretty sure now it's not a real signal is that we found during that period of time some other signals from other places in the sky that in that general part of the sky that seemed to be somewhat similar, although not identical. So there's still a small possibility there's a real signal there. So we are mounting additional programs. One of the problems with the Southern Hemisphere is that right now there's only one suitable radio telescope, which is the Parkes Radio Telescope in Australia. We're just bringing online the Meerkat radio array in South Africa. So we do plan in the next few months a joint program to really intensively study Proxima Centauri.
You mentioned that in the end, you thought the signal was probably terrestrial interference. How much of a problem is that these days? And does that mean we should just kind of spend the money at some point and go on the far side of the moon where we have less interference?
Well, it's a very serious problem. I mean, we're literally in a sea of radio noise on the Earth. Mm. There are places in Australia, for example, that are considered the quietest in the planet. But even those are very noisy. There's, you know, whether it's a cell phone or, you know, a radio broadcast or satellites or whatever, there's interference everywhere. I'm a strong believer that if we really want to go to a quiet place, we want to go to the far side of the moon. Because the moon blocks the Earth's interference. The worrisome thing is we're already seeing radio, you know, transmitters, you know, in orbit around the moon. I mean, the Chinese placed a communications satellite, and you know, we're kind of hoping that there'll be some here, and we've begun to have discussions with the, or I should say, the community has, not just us, with the UN Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space and others. You know, is it possible to establish a radio quiet region on the far side of the moon, and then have some sort of protocols that say that communication satellites, you know, need to avoid that area and need to avoid frequencies, you know, that should be deconflicted. And we're maybe running out of time for that. So, you know, that's clearly one answer, and it's one I quite favor, is to you know, now they're not cheap, but I think that the new developments and especially lunar activities may make them affordable, that, you know, for tens of millions or most hundreds of millions, a rather capable radio observatory could be placed in the far side of the moon.
Yeah. And then moving to Breakthrough Starshot, which is an absolutely fascinating project. So what is the current status, sort of like what are any, say, remaining technological obstacles, and what is, you think, a feasible timeline for actually making that happen?
Well, there's probably about 30 major challenges. We've picked the three or four that we consider the what we call deal breakers. We're in the midst of rather intensive research and analysis projects I'll say now there's a fourth one. And the first one is, can we build a laser array on the Earth that's powerful enough and affordable that we can get the beam through the atmosphere with enough coherence, meaning it's a high-quality beam that you could push a light sail? And the answer to being able to build it, and that the technology of being able to control the beam quality is based on the research we did, particularly a significant result from the Australian National University, that we funded, by the way, it was that, yes, we can do that. And that's a major breakthrough. The second one, which is still a very much an open issue, is, can you build this laser array affordably, meaning sort of, you know, what are 10 billion euros or so? And, the jury is still out on that. We've got some research analysis, but there are some promising developments in both automating laser manufacture and also a different approach, which is, it's called VEXELS, which is a sort of a laser phased array module. And those look promising, but we won't know for another 6 months or so. The second major challenge was, can you build a light sail that's 5 or 10 meters in diameter that can hold together and reflect the power and not absorb enough of it, you know, for half hour to an hour, enough to accelerate this the payload to 20% the speed of light. We've had a major set of research on that, and fortunately, the answer is yes, and that's been managed for us by Professor Harry Atwater at Caltech. As part of that, we've also considered, you know, the challenge of how do you attach a nano satellite, you know, the sort of gram class spacecraft that is able to do all these things and has a camera and so on. And we've had some major breakthroughs in understanding how that could be done. And basically the answer is we're probably not going to attach what looks like a chip to this sail. We're going to distribute the electronic components throughout the entire sail. So it's an integrated kind of spacecraft that's a kind of a, you know, a thin film. And that itself is a major kind of a breakthrough for a lot of different things. I think it has a lot of commercial applications. The third one is the the communications. We're just in the process of doing that research. We're about halfway through, and you know, that's probably the biggest challenge. How do you get a laser beam back from Alpha Centauri? And on this sort of, you know, several gram spacecraft, we think we have ways to do that. Right now, the biggest challenge in that, and this is what I call the fourth challenge, is how do you power it?
Yeah.
You know, we'd like tens of watts, and we know how to get maybe, you know, up to a watt. So we've got, you know, there are promising approaches. One of those, interestingly enough, is to basically harvest power from, you know, something going, you know, 20% the speed of light. It's going through the interstellar gas medium, and actually, you know, that will heat one side relative to the other of some sort of a electrical converter. So we might be able to do that if we can figure out the geometry. We also are looking at radioactive power sources, as well as actually, if you're in the Alpha Centauri system, you know, directly harvesting power from the from the starlight. So it's a, I would call it, it's not a solar panel. It's a Alpha Centauri panel.
Yeah. But that makes sense. I would have asked you about the communications, because I mean, it seems that if you want to close what we call in SATCOM the link budget, then I guess you would. I mean, even if you get to the power levels you mentioned, it probably means we would need a very, very big receiver on Earth, right?
Well, it's not trivial, but we think that if we started, we would actually use the light sail itself as a focusing element.
Okay.
And so, you know, you'd have a 5 or 10 meter directed beam. Of course, we've got to be able to then point it at the Earth accurately enough. But if you can get a few tens of watts, we could probably get up to and we would use a telescope, for example, like the new class of extremely large telescopes being built today, the sort of 30, 40 meter class telescope, that would be sufficient to get maybe hundreds of bits to a kilobit per second. So it's comparable to the deep space probes that we've already sent. Now that, by the way, if we're able to do that, that sort of revolutionizes, you know, how we do, you know, in our own solar system, deep space. And there's a lot of interest in NASA and other space agencies about very efficient laser communications.
Okay, so beyond the breakthrough Starshot and the other breakthrough current projects, what are some of the missions that you think should be done that you would like to do?
Well, I'm very excited about you know, is it possible to build cheap large space optics, and you know, the particularly if you look at, in fact, I think Elon Musk has talked a little bit about this, is that the Starship, you know, can launch, you know, many tens of tons, and that this may make it possible, you know, space telescopes today are billions of dollars, and we can do that for, you know, order of magnitude cheaper or more. And so I'm very excited about that. I'm also excited recently about the idea of using light sail technology to access the entire solar system. There's a group at Caltech led by Slava Tarechev, a professor there, who has actually been proposing, and it's funded by NASA, you know, solar light sails, you know, things. And it turns out if you do what's called a sun diver, you can drop something into, you know, even 2/10 of an astronomical unit, and the sunlight's powerful enough to push it to, you know, 5 or 10 astronomical units a year, which means now we can access the entire solar system in years, not decades. If you can go closer to the sun, you know, like a few hundredths of an astronomical unit. Now there's a lot of thermal issues on that. You might be able to get to 100 astronomical units a year. Now you're still not at relativistic speeds, but that would make it possible for us to get to, you know, some very exciting places in the outer solar system, like the Oort cloud. One in particular I'm very excited about is, and this is the basis of the studies they did for NASA, is called a solar gravity lens imager. And it turns out at about 500 astronomical units out, you know, 500 times the distance of the Earth to the sun, there's a point where the sun itself acts as a million kilometer lens. It actually, you know, due to general relativity, it bends starlight. Mm-hmm. So you actually can act, so you've got a focus point. And that's, you know, a million kilometer telescope is it can give you resolution that we could actually maybe see surface structure on planets orbiting some of the nearby stars.
Wow.
And now it's a hard challenge. There's a lot of technical questions. But that's another one that I'm very excited about. But even before we can do that, even going 5 or 10 astronomical units a year, I just had a meeting a few weeks ago with the leaders of this team, and they believe that a 5-kilogram spacecraft that could be a solar sail would enable us to get very significant missions. This sort of allows us to have CubeSat-sized payloads that can go all around the solar system. So I think it now makes it possible to do, solar system-wide missions that would be, million-dollar class or million-euro class rather than, billion. So again, I'm very excited about these developments that, a combination of low-cost, very heavy launch, using new technology using things like light sails that we might have access to the entire solar system. And finally, of course, is we've discussed in the past, new propulsion. And, I'm very excited about fusion. Of course, anybody that watches The Expanse knows that's how they got around the solar system, is efficient.
Epstein drive.
Yeah, but I think we may be close to the Epstein drive. I think there's in the next decade, there's some very interesting possibilities, which now makes it possible to build a spaceship that's like a real ship, so that most of it isn't fuel, most of it is payload. And I think that'll open up most of the solar system to human activities, which is, to me, very exciting.
I mean, if we stay within our solar system, I mean, you mentioned before that one of the main, if not the main objective at Breakthrough is sort of looking out for, answering the question whether there is life, whether, simple or intelligent life. And in other places, I mean... how much are you also looking at places in the solar system? We had Venus was obviously in the news about a year ago with the potential phosphine signature. Then we always get periodical appearances of places like Europa with its ocean, Enceladus with its ocean, Titan with maybe a different form of life. How much are you looking at those places as well?
Well, very much so. We had a series of studies the last few years. The first study we looked at Enceladus, which has plumes of water that are ejected into space, and some evidence of simple organic molecules in it. And then we also did a much more in-depth study on Europa, where there's evidence or some evidence of similar plumes, and we're still looking at those. One of our concerns is making sure that the cost is reasonable, but we had a major set of studies that. The lead for those studies, especially the Europa one, was John Grunsfeld, the Hubble repair astronaut and also the former head of science at NASA. And he's still working with us closely. We've just completed a study that Professor Sarah Seeger at MIT did for us about looking for life in the upper Venusian atmosphere. And, at the current time, we haven't chosen to do any of those missions yet, but there's growing interest in it, both by the part of our sponsor and other sponsors, including space agencies. So, those studies, I think, have helped move that along. We may decide, we have a process to go through to decide that we have advisory panels and all these topics to really vet those and also to look at the cost and risk. As a privately funded effort, we're certainly able to take much larger risks than space agencies. On the other hand, one of our concerns about Europa was that, even with that, the cost was several hundred million, is that the evidence of the plumes indicate on Europa that, unlike Enceladus, they're more intermittent. And it was certainly a concern on our part that if you spent hundreds of millions of dollars to go to Europa and you want to see Old Faithful and Old Faithful wasn't working that week, we really need more evidence that there's extant plumes all the time there. And so those are things that we're certainly looking at. So I'd say that's very much an open question. And we have been working with NASA and other agencies, space agencies on that.
Yeah. And a number of these places the agencies are going back. I think Venus, we have now 2 announced missions by NASA recently. And then Europa, we have the Europa Clipper. And but I think all of this comes back to the propulsion question, right? Because I think at current propulsion technologies, all of these places like the Jovian, Saturnian moons are basically 5 to 7 years away, right?
At the minimum, and then you need a very large booster. Now, I will say Venus is a little more accessible. Mm-hmm. We have been in discussions with the Rocket Lab, which is planning mm-hmm. a private mission to Venus in 2023. Yeah. Indeed, one of our the study recommendations is that we put a small instrument on that one, and that's under active discussion with our technical advisors, and so that's possible. That's clearly one of the recommendations. I mean, the most interesting recommendation of Professor Seeger's study was that what you eventually might want to do is bring a sample of the Venusian atmosphere back. Mm. And just to remind folks, there's a level at about 50 kilometers that's very interesting. That's the level that the paper that she and her colleagues, particularly Professor Graves in the UK, was the primary author, found evidence of phosphine. Now, that's been disputed, although I tend to be on the side that it's real. And those are at this level about 50 kilometers above the surface of Venus, where the atmospheric pressure and temperature is about the same as on the Earth. So eventually, it may be easier to pull a sample of the Venusian atmosphere than maybe a sample of the surface of Mars. So we've begun to look at that as a serious question.
So I haven't caught up with all of the papers. Was it that the evidence of phosphine itself was disputed, or that it was disputed that the phosphine may be from organic processes?
Well, there were both. The primary criticism initially was that it was a radio line that was detected with the ALMA mm-hmm. radio array mm-hmm. In Chile was misidentified, that it was actually some other mm-hmm. chemical. Okay. And I think that's still under discussion, but there are now a number of alternative detections that any one of them can be disputed, but it does appear that there is something very interesting, some what's called non-equilibrium gas, probably phosphine, at those levels in the Venusian atmosphere. But now a lot of the discussion has shifted from not whether there's something there, but can it be produced by volcanic processes? We know there's volcanic processes that go on in Venus or have gone on in the past. I would say that Professor Seeger's made a compelling case to us that it's very unlikely that those processes would work. She's also been able to show with lab experiments and research that there are, one of the concerns has been that in that level, the Venusian atmosphere, although the temperature and pressure is sort of Earth-like, the chemical constituents, you're right in the middle of the clouds, and the clouds are sulfuric acid droplets, mm-hmm. very, very pure sulfuric acid droplets, and that's a very inhospitable thing to Earth life. But she's been able to show that there are processes that life could use to survive in that, for example, neutralizing the sulfuric acid with ammonia, which is also present. And there's not a lot of water there, but there's some. And the interesting possibility is that, Venus probably had oceans a lot longer than Mars did. Mars under a billion years. Venus, by most of the models, had oceans for 2 billion years. Life could have arisen there as it did on Earth, or it could have come from Earth or from Mars or even from interstellar space. And that life, assuming that the heating of Venus happened fairly slowly, which it probably did over hundreds of millions or billions of years, that life could have slowly evolved as it does on Earth in very inhospitable environments. I mean, we know there's life on Earth in some very strange places like, hot springs with very high sulfuric acid content. Although I might add the sulfuric acid on Mars is much purer than it is in a boiling hot springs on Earth. Mm. But still, I mean, there are things that are very close to the boiling point where there's life. So, Venus' atmosphere might be, absolutely hospitable in comparison to those, but life on Earth evolved to those niches. So we just don't know. My personal view is I think there is life there, and it's evolved to a very strange form, but, we need to go see.
Yeah. And then sort of on the question of, let's call it the biomarkers in the broadest sense. Let me just go out a little bit on a limb and forgive me. But so another one that was in the news, of course, 1 or 2 years ago was the sort of the objects from outside the solar system I think the first one being Oumuamua. Right. And there was a bunch of papers about that. Avi Loeb from Harvard being very vocal, sort of proposing it might have been a light sail, but on the topic of light sails. Is that kind of stuff? Are you watching that as well on the side? And,
I'm very excited about that. I mean, Avi Loeb is both a good friend of mine, a distinguished scientist, and the chairman of our Starshot Advisory Committee. So I take it very seriously. What little information we had, his point was a very legitimate one, that Oumuamua was perhaps more consistent with the light sails we were developing. And it had a number of other features that he said it was, it could have been a deliberate probe. I tend to say that I'm skeptical, but I don't dismiss that. And I really think he did a great service by raising that. There are now a lot of other, interstellar objects. In fact, it looks like there's a lot more interstellar objects than we ever thought of, which, by the way, to me, raises the possibility that life in our solar system came from elsewhere. And that's sort of a different topic. But, I think that, that one needs to take that seriously, that, in fact, if some of these sort of are early, sundiver light sail things work, we can go chase some of those objects. And, there's nothing like a close-up image.
Yep.
Now, at the same time, of course, there's a lot of interest in UFOs, which I'm always asked, first of all, I used to be in the Air Force. Did I know anything about it? And the very short and definitive answer is no, I didn't know of anything about that. That doesn't mean that the government didn't know anything about it, but, at least this particular retired general didn't know anything about it. And has no evidence there's anything real there. I think my, uninformed guess is that there's a real phenomenon, but it has nothing to do with aliens. I sort of am skeptical of people that immediately jump that, well, we saw this thing and it had to be aliens. But I do commend, I know Professor Loeb started a new institute to try to investigate these things scientifically and look at to me, one good idea, and I think he's promoted this, was, and I will say that our foundation is not, this is not our area, but certainly hopefully somebody would fund it, is, there are hundreds of satellites in orbit around the Earth that imaging the whole planet every day. Mm-hmm. And, in fact, one group is my friends and former employees that founded Planet. They've got, what, 300 or 400 satellites.
Sure.
It would seem to me that it would be fairly easy to if nothing else, look through their databases and not be a terribly expensive thing. Also maybe target some of these places that people claim these things are seen, like naval test ranges. And I think that's a scientific thing to be done. But I think it's important that we are looking at phenomena that we can study. It's interesting to me that, particularly the last few years, we've done a lot of surveying of the sky, and we don't, other than the signal that we're not quite 100% certain is terrestrially or man-made, there's been very little real data. So I guess my admonition to people is, if you want to scientifically look at the UFO phenomenon, look to our planet.
That's fair enough. So, by the way, speaking about Oumuamua and sort of the light sail hypothesis, we've been mentioning light sails all along, as a very interesting way of getting around the solar system, possibly beyond. So possibly a naive question. I guess then there's no issue with that, the material being degraded by cosmic radiation or anything like that. So we have that part solved.
It looks like we've the work that Professor Atwater and his team have done appears that these materials are, would be viable for, decades, if not centuries, in interstellar space.
Okay. And let me follow up one final question, which I realized I forgot to ask when we were talking about Breakthrough Starshot. So once the light sail gets us to the Alpha Centauri system, once we're there, sort of captured by, the gravity of any body there, would we then ditch the light sail, or what would actually happen?
Well, the speed we're going, we don't know any way to stop it unless there's a laser in Alpha Centauri system that would.
Right.
That would,
yes.
And so we, it's like the, New Horizons Pluto flyby. We just fly by and take image data and send it back. There are concepts for stopping in the Alpha Centauri system using light sails. We would have to go slower, about at least a factor of maybe 10 to 100 slower. And you'd have to have a bigger light sail, lighter one. But there have been papers published that say we could, you know, maybe in the, you know, with a little more technology, be able to stop there and stay in the system. Although I think it's more likely that that sometime in the next century, that fusion systems, which barely get you there, but they could get a fairly large payload and stop in the Alpha Centauri system. You know, calculations show that, that you know, a five-stage fusion rocket that you would have to build in space, but that would be the size of maybe the International Space Station, or not too much bigger, would be sufficient. Now, it doesn't get there as fast as, you know, we get there in 20 years. It may take a century. But this is beginning to say that that the nearby stars and those stellar systems are accessible within, you know, time scales that, that, you know, people alive today may, you know, may live to see become real.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. And I guess then just one final question just occurred to me about this now. So let's suppose there was a, let's call it an inverse breakthrough Starshot, sort of like Yuri Milner, Pete Worden equivalents on Alpha Centauri's planets, sending a chip-sized device at sort of a fraction of the speed of light by the Earth. Would we even detect that?
No, we wouldn't.
Interesting.
That's the interesting thing, that the sail is pretty small. It goes through pretty, it goes through the system pretty fast. You know, it would, it and our systems are not going to go that close to the planet. So we would not detect those. You know, Oumuamua certainly wasn't going at 20% the speed of light. You know, it was at sort of standard interstellar asteroid rates. So, I mean, if it was an intelligent system, it took a long time to get here. And, so it's, you know, now that doesn't mean that, you know, I don't know what time scales aliens would operate under. One of the most interesting things is we don't even know what life is. And the other areas of research we've been looking at is try to define life. And the best work to date on that has actually been done by Professor Lee Cronin at the University of Glasgow. And he's indicated that that life doesn't have to be based on carbon chemistry or anything similar to our chemistry. But the way to identify it is chemical complexity, that he's shown that there's a certain level of complexity that natural processes can produce in chemicals, but that you know, everything that is indicative of life is much more complex. So, you know, he thinks we should look for complexity rather than look for, you know, DNA or RNA or carbon compounds, is to look for complexity. So that's an area that has a lot of promise to continue to be looked at.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
We may even find there's other life on Earth, and but we just haven't looked for it right.
Yeah, so people call the shadow biosphere hypothesis. Yeah. And so we've talked a lot about the solar system and even Alpha Centauri and beyond. So let's go a little bit closer back towards Earth, the moon. I mean, we've mentioned Starship before, and I mean, there's a lot of people who probably correctly say that, you know, if Starship works, then especially if the refueling in orbit works, we may suddenly find ourselves with 100-ton plus transport capacity, which is, I mean, it's much larger than even the Apollo landers. So it's going to really open up the moon. So what should we do with the moon? What do you think is going
to
happen?
You know, to be ecumenical, I should say that it's not just Starship. I mean, Blue Origin has their systems. NASA and other people are developing, you know, large system. I'm of the opinion that you know, large scale industrialization of space is very much in humankind's benefit. You know, I think Jeff Bezos said that you know, look, we should move heavy industry off our planet and keep the Earth for light industry. I mean, one of the best ways to save the Earth is to remove some of the, you know, the most dangerous pollutants. But to even a, you know, so that's the first objective. The second one is that I think that the human species you know, needs to expand. Expand, if nothing else, to back up our species. And the moon is the obvious first location. I mean, Mars is probably not far behind. Elon Musk would argue that it's better on Mars. I mean, my question there is, until we know whether there's extant life on Mars, we should probably focus on a place we are pretty sure there's not extant life, the moon. But I think we're on the road to becoming an interplanetary species with a robust economy, probably within a few decades. And the robust economy will help, you know, save the Earth. I mean, one of the things I've talked about a little bit, although this has nothing to do with breakthrough, is that I think, you know, people worried about climate change, which I think is a very serious challenge, is that one of the longer term solutions, you know, it was later this century, is that you give the Earth sunglasses, and you actually build at the Earth-Sun, or actually inside the Earth-Sun Lagrange point, a large set of light shades, which could be based on the same light sail technology. If you could block a percent or two of the sunlight, which is feasible, it's very expensive, but with things like Starship, it's becoming more feasible, and especially using lunar resources to do it, then we could actively cool the planet in a way to balance things. And it may be necessary to do that anyhow. Now, I know there's a lot of challenges. People say, well, if you're fiddling with the inputs at that, how do you know you're not going to goof it up? That's a good question. But by putting things at the Lagrange point, it's easy to move them. And and if you don't do anything to maintain it there, it just goes away. It's blown away by solar radiation pressure. So it's, I think that the active development of the moon, first of all, for industrialization, and second for habitation, and third for is a source of resources and material that could actually fix the planet, I think are compelling and indeed mandatory if we're going to survive as a species.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So in terms of, we've discussed a lot of very exciting sort of forward-looking things, the potential for some very exciting missions. I mean, I guess generally in the space sector right now, it's sort of a sensation of great optimism right across the board on like upcoming science mission, on the commercial side, all of those startup companies, some of them now at a very advanced stage. You mentioned Planet, where I think you were around for the inception of the company. Now it's a listed company with a multi-billion-dollar market cap. So there's generally a lot of optimism on space for the next few years, maybe even for the next one or two decades. Is there anything that worries you? Like, is there something where we could mess this up, where it could go wrong?
Well, there's always, there's always a lot of things that can then, run the whole future off the rails. And there's a couple. One of them is I see a growing, to use the English term, Luddite movement, there seems to be a lot of people that say, well, we shouldn't do any technology, we shouldn't do any space exploration or space activities. That's a significant, group and a significant political power. I think the most likely derailing of this is going to be kind of Luddite movement. I mean, and that's a serious challenge. So it's basically that political opinions prevent, making these areas of progress. Of course, related to that is that, if the Earth erupts into conflict, the more, sort of exploration and development things tend to be put aside. That's clearly a challenge. I mean, the third one is that if the environment degrades badly enough that we're, that you begin to have destruction of the economy, then, and other problems, they could be all these factors, you tend to have a huge contraction of your horizon. So all of those are potential challenges. I think the other one is, of course, that I have to confess is that I'm an inveterate optimist, and I get accused of being an optimist, that, I think it's, many experts have said, look, that space experts have said since the 30s that we were going to have, traveling throughout the solar system, become interplanetary species. And in fact, my real, kind of role model and mentor was Arthur C. Clarke. I and a colleague have just finished a draft of a book that we've dedicated to Arthur C. Clarke. We can talk about that some other time. Mm-hmm. He's often accused. I read some of the things he wrote in the as early as the 30s into the 50s that, we're way behind his schedule. So, but the other thing he said was that, I think it's something, paraphrase it, that if a learned expert tells you something is possible in a certain date, he's usually wrong on the date. But if an expert tells you something is impossible, they're almost assuredly wrong. Mm. So I tend to be on the side of Sir Arthur that we're going to go there. It might not be as fast as we think.
Yeah, yeah. So if we continue on the optimist side and assume that space is going to be exciting for the foreseeable future, you mentioned Breakthrough was also founded with a focus on young people and and having role models for young people. If you are for the young persons who are listening to us, and whether they're interested in science or the commercial aspects of space, is there any sort of advice with regard to what maybe some exciting areas to pay particular attention to?
Well, I mean, it's always hard to look in a crystal ball, but, you know, my advice to people entering their careers is, first of all, become as technically oriented as you can, you know, focus on you know, science and mathematics. Those will always put you right. I think to get in specific areas, obviously space is in general, and particularly space propulsion is a very exciting area. Mm-hmm. Another area, and we've talked about this a lot, I think the whole question of life and genetic engineering and so forth is a very exciting field, and it's inevitably going to play a major role in humans living and prospering on other planets. First of all, we're probably going to have to tailor Earth life to survive there, including our own, which is always fraught with challenges. But another area is obviously advanced computing. I'm particularly excited about quantum computing.
Quantum computing,
The ability to make now, you know, many orders of magnitude of improvement in what we can do. So, you know, those are kind of the areas I'd say were exciting: propulsion, advanced life science, particular life engineering, and quantum computing.
Yeah, fully agree. And so we always finish up with the last question I ask is about science fiction. We've actually touched upon science fiction a few times already with Arthur C. Clarke, you mentioned, and then of course the three-body problem and The Expanse. What is some of your favorite science fiction?
Well, I have to say Arthur C. Clarke is, you know, hands down my favorite author. And, a lot of science fiction authors talk about various futures. And one of the key things is why do we go into space? And there are probably at least four different reasons. I mean, one is obviously for national interest and national power. Mm-hmm. Clearly, that's what drove the space program in the past. Second is for knowledge with science. A third one is to make life better, you know, for humans, which is, you know, obviously what people like Bezos and Musk are trying to do, make a profit along the way too, I might add. And but the last one is really what I attribute to Arthur C. Clarke, that space is about the endless adventure. And one of my favorite, well, there were two of my favorite books of his. One of them was The Fountains of Paradise, which is really about the human spirit. And it was about the space elevator, but it also juxtaposed it with past history in Sri Lanka, his second home. But the other one is the Songs of Distant Earth that we talked about, interstellar expansion and the human spirit. So those are the areas I find most exciting. And clearly in, you know, kind of popular science fiction, I think The Expanse is because it talks about a near future based on a technology we think is real. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'll dismiss the alien elements, which obviously make it more interesting and exciting. But it talks about a future where we're still humans with a lot of our foibles and challenges as well as advantages that is now spread around the solar system and based on, I think, primarily the fusion technology that they use.
Yeah, which may be closer in time than people realize. Fingers crossed. Exactly. Pete, my final question. You mentioned the Swedish prizes whose name we don't want to mention. They're actually being announced or starting to be announced this week. When are the breakthrough prizes actually being announced?
Well, we've already announced the breakthrough prize winners. I think we did that a week or two ago.
Okay.
And I don't recall. I don't have all the list in front of me. But for this year, you know, unfortunately, we're not going to be able to have a major ceremony. The other prize that'll be announced soon is the one for young people, the Breakthrough Junior Challenge, where I'm one of the judges on that. That's where we ask people ages of 13 and 18 to do a couple minute video on some fundamental principle of physics, mathematics, or life sciences. I don't know who the final winner was. We forward a very short list to our sponsors. There's a number of sponsors that we interact with and pick a final winner. But I can tell you that very impressive, and that should be announced here in a few weeks.
Great. And we'll put a link in the show notes to the various breakthrough foundations and breakthrough prize. Pete, thank you so much. I hope we can do this again in 1 or 2 years. There's so much to talk about, and speak soon.
Thank you, Raphael. We'll see you soon.
Well, that's it for another nominal episode of the Space Business Podcast. If you like this podcast, please consider giving it a 5-star rating on your favorite podcast platform, such as iTunes. You can follow us on Twitter @podcast_space. Also consider supporting us at www.patreon.com/spacebusinesspodcast. If the podcast got you interested in learning more about the business opportunities in the space economy, check out my new online course on space entrepreneurship on udemy.com. The link is in the episode description. Lastly, if you have any feedback, including ideas for guests, and that may include yourself if you have an exciting space story to tell or interested in being a sponsor, drop us an email at spacebusinesspodcast@gmail.com. I look forward to seeing you for the next episode.